promoting unity.
Thank you so much, Ramadan. It's good to talk to you again.
Likewise, and we look forward to your participation and presence on here, and all of the people who come before you. You're following in big footsteps, and I know you can fill in here. You've been on the department about 7 years now, then, right?
That's correct. Yeah, I was in patrol for the majority of that time. Most recently, I was in the community-oriented policing office over at our downtown area command. So here I am now embarking on this new journey in the public information office.
Okay, and sound like you're a part of that rich, growing diversity at LVMPD, whose parents and or grandparents probably migrated here from another part of the world or from another country.
Yeah, that's correct. My parents are both from Mexico, and I'm a first-generation American.
Right.
Grew up in Los Angeles, and was born out there, and actually grew up most of my life was out here in Las Vegas. So I'm pretty.
We got a lot of people from California here, and so we'll have more information to talk about it, more about the migration of people. But also, Las Vegas, as you also know, is growing as one of the most diverse cities in the country, probably eighth in the country in terms of diversity. We're probably second and third in terms of diversity in education and even in terms of marriages. And around it, we're also very diverse in terms of religion and faith organizations. And the more we know about each other, obviously, the better we function together. Our guest this morning, Dr. Y. Apps Aslandogan, and I'm going to get his name correctly here. He's from the Alliance of Shared Values, and he's our guest this morning to speak to us about some matters that are very vast in terms of some of the things that public safety indirectly deals with, but when they work well, public safety is less involved. And the organization around shared values really has some of those concepts within it. But Dr. Aslandogan, are you on the line with us, sir?
Yes, good morning.
Good morning, Dr. Y. If you don't mind if I can say that, Dr. Y, is it okay?
Yeah, my students call me Dr. Alp, if that's easier.
Alp, then we will do that. We will do that because we're students to you this morning, and welcome to our...
No, I'm a student myself, too.
And we all are, and I thank you for coming on and share with us some of the ideas and concepts and things that you have worked on at a national level, but we here through the Interfaith Council of Southern Nevada work on similar issues of interfaith dialogue, and we're quite interested in one hearing about the Alliance for Shared Values that you're currently the executive director of. If you give a little background on, well, before we do that, a little background on yourself, as a matter of fact, because I understand you're a computer, your education was in computer science.
Yes, I came to the States as a graduate student and studied computer science, served as a faculty professor for a while, and for the last several years I've been leading this organization.
Mm-hmm. And the Alliance for Shared Values, because in America, as you can see, and you yourself being a new migrant here, also part of himself, his parents and our grandparents migrated here. America's a diverse country of a lot of different people and a lot of backgrounds. The Alliance for Shared Values, what's its role? What's its direction and its mission?
Yes, we are a loose umbrella for several local organizations. Our local partners, their common mission is bringing different people together around a shared concern, a shared cause. We particularly focus on bringing Muslims to the table, so bringing Muslims, Christians, Jews, atheists, Buddhists, Hindus, all of us around the table or around the project, a social responsibility project, so that we can see each other as fellow humans rather than just labels.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. You know, it's a big issue that we're dealing with in this country now, because it's producing a great deal of tension in terms of how we see one another. And you yourself, you have a history of working in, what brought you into the field of working and helping people learn how to get along and have shared values and have a common understanding? How long have you been involved in this work? What brought you into this work?
Well, my involvement actually started out more than 30 years ago when I was a college student. I met a few folks who were part of this movement called the Hizmet Movement. Hizmet in Turkish means service, like serving your community in that sense. And one of their ideals was a society where people respect the differences rather than seeing them as a threat to themselves. You know, they were Muslims, but they were modern Muslims. They embraced science and democracy and arts. So it was very appealing to me. There was this preacher who was an excellent preacher, very logical, very eloquent, and also he embraced science, he embraced democracy. So it was very appealing to me, and my work essentially started at that time. Of course, you know, in those years, in the 80s and 90s of Turkey, the work was within Turkey. The movement did not go abroad, did not become global yet. But in Turkey, there were, you know, similar polarization, similar fracture lines as in America today. There were no blacks and whites.
In America?
Were... Sorry.
No. Uniquely now, America, we're, you know, our demographics were constantly shifting and growing, as many countries in Europe are also. Can we develop those lines of dialogue and bring together and work around our shared values here in a country like this, a free and democratic and open society? And as you can see, we're deeply involved in getting ready to vote on November 3rd and all of the activity that goes into that. Is there an asset that you can add to that?
You know, in the moment, we all believe that it is possible and it ought to be done. Of course, it's hard work. You know, when you don't meet people, when you just see them on the TV or just hear about them or read about them, they are just labels to you. You know, one is white, one is black, one is Latino, one is Caucasian, the other one is from another background, you know, your religion. Those are all labels. But when you come to the table or a project and meet each other as humans, all of a sudden you recognize, you know, there's a soul in this other person who comes from the same source. But this only is possible when you have a meaningful interaction. And that's sometimes it's hard to, you know, establish because people are afraid. People see the difference as a threat. But when it happens, it is magical. You know, you see people talking about the group in a negative way, and then they would say, but this one person is different because they met that person in person. And, you know, if we can spread this, it is definitely possible. And as a matter of fact, in India, there were studies done that showed that the violence between the Hindus and the Muslims was reduced significantly when Hindus and Muslims were part of civil organizations or institutional settings where they come together and work together.
Well, now here's another interesting equation here, and Officer Potter, I think we can, you know, you chime in here. Within communities, for instance, we have public safety, law enforcement, police departments, and then we have populations of color. So African American, Latinx, Hispanic, Latino. You probably seen the friction that goes on there. You know, we have Black Lives Movement, we have social justice movement. Can these concepts be utilized in order to help build relationships, say, between an agency or a police agency or public service agency and a population?
Absolutely. I think it goes back to what the doctor was talking about, that a lot of it is just based on misinformation, or maybe somebody is just not familiar with a different culture, and in our case, with law enforcement. I know when I was little, you know, growing up in Los Angeles, it was always instilled on us at a young age that, you know, the police were bad. And so anytime we would run across the police out on the streets or we would see a patrol car, it was always scary. And there was always that fear that, you know, I have to stay away from them. But I think that was mainly rooted in the fact that, you know, my parents came here from another country and they weren't too familiar with, you know, what the goal of law enforcement was out here. Right. They're out here to help. So it just goes into, you know, we have to learn about each other. We have to be open to learn about other cultures. You know, it goes to other religions as well.
Right.
Because if we all understand each other, we can all work better together.
No doubt. And build those relationships. Dr. Al, now, could those same methodology be used to build that relationship, to enhance that relationship that we were just speaking of?
I absolutely believe that's possible, but it takes effort and it takes people who are willing to take the first step of outreach, doing the difficult work, because it is very comfortable just to stay within your group, people who are like you, but just taking a step outside of that group and reaching out to somebody who is not like you, who doesn't think like you, who doesn't look like you, that takes courage. So it takes people who are willing to take that step.
So you say is that the first step? Reaching outside of your group?
Yes, that is the first step. And the next step is establishing a platform where people feel they are treated fairly, they are respected. Nobody is forcing them to accept anything. Nobody is trying to convert them or anything. But they are freely able to express themselves and also hear other people. And maybe more practically, more beneficially, if they are actually working toward a common cause. I mean, we have environmental problems. We have, you know, substance abuse problems. We have all kinds of problems in our society. When people of different backgrounds work together to solve these problems, there is a dialogue going on in that work, which is so meaningful. And without you realizing it, your perception of these other groups change.
What is it about, you know, we're now faced with this COVID pandemic that's probably sometimes as much as we can is forcing us to work together? What is it about the cohesion and that interaction that goes on that helps bring about more sympathy and empathy and even compassion towards one another? What is that process? What is happening there?
Yeah, well, I think, you know, the COVID crisis, in one way, it is very, I mean, it did affect us negatively. It stopped many of our activities and you know, from a dialogue perspective, it did prevent many of the in-person dialogue activities. But on the other hand, it is also helpful because it awakens humanity to the fact that we are all on the same boat. We all breathe the same air. So we cannot, we can no longer just claim that, you know, we have borders and everything stops in those borders, be it national borders or community, county borders. You know, life doesn't happen that way. So God, in a sense, is giving us a message that you, you know, you humanity, you better get your act together and realize that you are all on the same boat. And you need to begin collaboration. You need to begin cooperating with each other to solve these problems that affect all of you.
At community levels, at where they say it's the rubber meets the road, at how do we get, because in some places, for instance, the city we live in, Southern Nevada, Clark County, it's a very, very diverse, as we mentioned, population of probably now closing in on probably being close to 50-50 minority people of color and Caucasian white. And of course, there's also gaps between income. We've also noticed that through this COVID crisis, the disparity in healthcare, education, and economics, and several other areas. How do we balance that equation? What method do we use to bring those individuals together to see each other's common concern?
Yeah. Well, broadly speaking, you know, this approach, this method is known as civic engagement, and it means citizens of different backgrounds coming together, preferably under an institution, to solve a common problem or to bring about the desirable result. And again, I mean, this sounds wonderful, but it's hard at the beginning because people are reluctant to work with other people who are unlike others. So, you know, in my experience as a college student in Turkey, there were fracture lines between Turks and the Kurds, two big ethnicities in Turkey. There were the practicing Muslims and the more secular lifestyle people. There were the Sunnis and the Alevis within the practicing Muslims. And there were the political views, like the leftist and the rightist, the nationalist and the socialist. And, you know, the polarization was so big that people actually on the street, they would fight each other and they would kill each other. You know, thousands of Turkish youth died in the 60s and 70s on the streets. So the approach there of this preacher Fethullah Gulen and the Hizmet movement was, you know, in every group there are more reasonable people. So they invited these more reasonable people from different groups to a platform to discuss their common concerns and see common solutions and see if we can work together. And then through those more reasonable people, they were able to attract other people who are reluctant. So it's like a seed, you know, you pick a seed in a group and then you begin expanding that seed to larger and larger groups of people from that segment.
So similar to you bringing those individuals together, and as you were mentioning different population groups, I'm seeing this in America. When you were talking politically, I'm saying Democrat, Republican, Independent, you have Black Lives Matter, African American, Latinx, Officer Potter. Some of the things that LVMPD is doing in terms of, you say you're involved in COP and other programs, does it kind of mirror, do these programs reflect one another in any way?
Yeah, I think it mirrors it in the fact that we're, especially in COP, we're always doing outreach to communities. I know working in downtown, being that they have a large homeless problem over there, we're always working with the charities down there, Catholic Charities, Salvation Army, and with different other organizations to try to provide the outreach. We have our HOT team as well, our homeless outreach team, that every morning they go out to different camps. They offer resources to some of these folks that are, you know, living, you know, out on the streets. And the goal is to just provide them the resources that they need for them to get back on their feet, because nobody wants to be out there. You know, they for whatever reason, they've fallen on bad times, and now they're out living on the streets. But we want to help them get back on their feet. And it just goes back to working together. You know, if we can help a little bit, bring in other partners from the community, we can maybe try to, you know, put a little bit of a dent in this problem and improve the quality of life for the citizens of the community.
Dr. Alp made a note. He said, the more we get to know people and know about people and know about their culture, the better that relationship can be. Is that the same thing in policing? The more you know about people, the better you can have a working relationship with them. Is that pretty much consistent also?
Of course, yeah. We reach out to communities, lower socioeconomic communities, and people, you know, where, you know, a lot of times.
So getting to know them.
It's they see the police because, you know, they've either been the victim of a crime or, you know, somebody in their community has been the victim of a crime. And they see us in their neighborhoods all the time. But, you know, sometimes we don't necessarily have that interaction, you know, when we're out handling the call. So we have programs within the department, you know, for us to reach out to the community, establish that relationship. You know, and sometimes we'll go out there when, you know, proactively to tell them, hey, you know, we're not always just here to, when times are bad, we're out here to meet you and get to know you. And we want to establish that relationship because, again, you know,
right.
We can only do so much. We need the community's help as well. But
right.
In order to get that, we need to have that relationship established.
Right. So that's that point, because Dr. Alp is saying that same concept is used socially. So we can see they're actually the same. Dr. Alp, I want to borrow from you. Are also the editor of the Fountain Magazine, correct?
Yes.
And I do want to know that
in the
inmate population, not only in people like myself, and even some of the correction officers have read articles from the Fountain Magazine. And there's a quote here. It talks about the followers of HISMAT commit themselves to administering schools in places, diverse places such as Phnom Penh, Brussels, Ankara, the inner cities of Milwaukee, Cleveland. They are digging wells in Somalia and Mali, and running clinics in Kenya, and establishing interreligious dialogue programs in and around the United States. Are those avenues of bringing people together, but their service also includes looking at healthcare concerns and educational concerns?
Yes, HISMAT movement started out as an education movement, and at some point there were about 1,000 schools worldwide, half of them in Turkey, half of them outside of Turkey. So it started out as an education movement, especially bringing education opportunities to segments of the population who lack those opportunities. Think about girls in Pakistan, Afghanistan, or Nigeria, for instance. You know, it started out as an education movement, but later also branched into medical care, humanitarian relief. And many of those projects are continuing, except the ones in Turkey. Unfortunately, Turkey's authoritarian president, Erdogan, shut them down all in Turkey.
Mm-hmm. Well, you know, it's interesting because here in southern Nevada, the contingency and the people who are involved in HISMAT under the Silver Sage Foundation are doing similar outreach and interactive work. But I guess in all places, it's no one size fits all. And it's kind of like in policing, all of us are part of, in different area commands, we do different things. And under HISMAT, depending on what city you're engaged in, because in here, they're very engaged with the homeless. And so we're probably going to be looking at ideas and concepts where organizations like the Silver Sage Foundation can work with public safety to provide provide avenues of the homeless making a transition to finding a lifestyle that better accommodates them as human beings. So there's good room for partnerships. But Dr. Alb, I think we can continue to work from the principle that you're talking about bringing people together and getting to know one another.
Absolutely, and also around bringing them together around common concerns and common desires of the society.
So when we look at, say, like violent crime in a neighborhood or domestic violence, bringing different groups of people around together to work on concepts like that?
Absolutely. The work needs to be done in two fronts. One is the local dimension. You know, the local problems are, of course, the top priority. But sometimes, interestingly, focusing on a little bit distant problem may help resolve the internal tensions within a community. For instance, a group of people from the same community working to bring help to, let's say, people suffering from the water crisis in Michigan, right? So that may actually help resolve the local tensions within our community here.
Yes, yes. So I can certainly see the benefits of that. Officer Potter, does it benefit LVMPD to have a working relationship with different organizations like this in terms of public safety?
Of course it does. Organizations like Alliance for Shared Values, I mean, they're great because they go out and do the outreach that, you know, is needed sometimes for some of the people that we deal with on a daily basis. The resources that they offer to those people are essential because at the end of the day, it's going to be a win-win situation. We benefit from not having to go out again and rearrest somebody for something that they've done. Because, you know, at the end of the day, we don't want to take people to jail. We want to offer them help. Sometimes we have to take people to jail, but, you know, when they get out, we want to make sure that they have all the resources that they need to be able to better themselves and that they don't fall back into the, you know, their footsteps and end up in jail again. But at the end of the day, that's our goal.
Well, you know, I think that the goal of better communities, these both organizations mirror one another and operating in different venues. And Dr. Alp, we had another actually interesting engagement between the local group of Silver Sage Foundation and what we call area commands, Southern Nevada Clark County Police Department. Say Metro is broken up into different communities. They're called area commands. One of our area commands hosted a Lilato Carter or a Night of Power celebration, and it was under Captain Sasha Larkin and one of the local leaders from the interfaith group at Silver Sage Foundation participated in sharing what the Night of Power actually was. So this is a police department that really functions, not just talks about it, but really walks the walk and talks the talk of understanding diversity and multiculturalism and pluralism and how to get the most mileage out of it. And of course, it is public safety, but we benefit from this type of discussion because we see that from the spiritual, from the religious, from the human development standpoint, many of the things that this department is doing mirrors what you are also doing. And we have to commend you, Hismet, Sheikh Gulen, and Fethullah Gulen for the fine work that you're doing in these areas and how we're benefiting from it. And certainly a large portion of inmate populations in Clark County Corrections and Detention Facility benefit from your Fountain Magazine and the many excellent articles that go into that. That's informative in education, very academic, but very insightful in terms of building values and building a good decision-making and how to deal with peer group influences. Any closing comments to us as we close on the show? And we'd like to thank you again for coming on and being a guest. And we hope in future endeavors, when you're doing different things around shared values, that you'll be willing to call back and talk to us again. Any closing comments to us?
Well, I thank you for this opportunity. I think, you know, solution to many of our social problems lies in the realization of the human soul in the other, so that we can reach out for the human dignity in each person, and that's only possible through human to human contact. I hope that we can expand opportunities for that.
You know, I think this type of dialogue that you just shared, your closing comments, is what Black Lives Matter and others need to also talk about together. that human care and that human. This is exactly what I think the Black Lives Matter movement really is saying, that we have that common cause. A different type of language is used, but I think the theme is really the same. And I hope that some way that those linkages can be made so we can find this continual growth of diversity and acceptance of that idea that while we are all different, we're really all just one human population. They say, 99.9% of the human genome is the same. Very little about us as human beings.
Yeah.
So thank you for coming on and sharing us on Police Promoting Unity. And I hope that we can follow your lines of thinking and that idea and direction of working together. Officer Porter, on your part, any closing or comments from yourself?
I think that it's important just to, you know, like you said, be able to understand each other, because at the end of the day, we all want to live happy, prosperous, and safe lives in our community. Sometimes there's some misunderstanding between groups, but I would encourage everybody out there to just, you know, be familiar with people around you. Be familiar with your police department, because at the end of the day, if we understand each other a little bit better, we're going to be able to work better together and accomplish some of those common goals that we have.
Well, you know, Dr. Al, we have one of the projects here with this department is called a Metro's Multicultural Advisory Council Group. And some of your members at Silver Sage Foundation, actually some of the businessmen who are part of the Turkish community, hosted a luncheon for the advisory council. This council is made up of people of different ethnic, racial, religious backgrounds, organizations, social organizations, civic organizations, ADL, Anti-Defamation League, NAACP, ACLU. It's a rich mixture of organizations and people that meet monthly with the sheriff and his executive staff of the largest police agency here in Southern Nevada, Clark County, numbering some 4,000 sworn and another 2,500, so about 7,000 staff, providing public safety throughout Southern Nevada, Clark County. And we do the things that you really talk about. We really have to work on more and more getting to know one another, but we've done a reasonably good job, but there's always so much more work to be done. So we're certainly moving in that direction, and we appreciate the ideas and the themes that you can bring and share with us, and we wish you well and pray you well. And to our listening audience, we hope that for all of us, and I just was involved in an academy at the corrections department just recently, and the population there looked like America 2060. That is the recruits in the corrections academy. It was probably one-third, 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 which actually means that the academy was largely populations of color. And that's the first time I've ever seen that in the academy, that the populations of recruits, there were 40 recruits, Officer Porter, and the larger portion, over 50% of those recruits, were men and women of color. And I'll tell you what was interesting. That was the first time. It's the first time the Hispanic Latino had the largest population in that class. Now, they were in week 7. We can't determine who's going to graduate. But the Hispanic Latino population had the largest number there. And I think that shows that recruiting is working. So, Dr. Al, this is some of the many things that we're doing in trying to cross-pollinate and bring about a better understanding between public safety and the communities they provide the public safety to, and quite frankly, borrowing from some of the ideas and concepts that you shared with us today. To our listening audience, we appreciate you allowing for us, with our guests, to call in, and with the Office of Public Information, the Office of Ms. L. Porter, and sharing your day, and we hope that there's something that you can gain and benefit from it. And we are in difficult times, and there may be more difficult times ahead, but in every dark cloud, there's a silver lining, and as the Book of Psalms says, this too shall pass. And in closing, our remarks for the day is, remember, I'm going to borrow from one of the administrators of the Coral Academy, shared this with me. It made note of a philosophical quote. It says, hard times create strong men and women. Strong men and women create good times. Good times create weak men and women. And weak men and women create hard times. Let's have a good day and work on being strong and create good times. We'll talk to you next week on another edition of Police Promoting Unity.